بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد We glorify Allah Ta'ala and seek blessings and salutations of peace for the noble Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his Sahaba and those who follow him in upholding the cause of the right religion. Our last lesson was about the printing of the Holy Quran, that the Noble Quran was first printed at Hamburg in 1113 Hijri, and in 787 AD the Quran Karim was printed at Petersburg, a Russian city. In 1828 AD the Quran was printed by lithography on stone slabs in the Iranian city of Tehran. And an introduction to the science of tafsir, that literally the meaning of tafsir is to open or to explain. And technically the science of tafsir is a branch of knowledge in which the meaning of the Quran are explained and its injunctions and wisdoms are described openly and clearly. And the six sources of tafsir: number one, the glorious Quran itself; number two, the hadith; number three, the reports from Sahaba; number four, the reports from Tabi'in or successors; number five, the Arabic language. And today we would read about source number six, deliberation and deduction. The last source of tafsir consists of deliberation and deduction. The subtleties and mysteries of the Noble Quran are an ocean with no shore, no end. Therefore, the more a person who has been blessed with insight into the Islamic science by Allah Almighty deliberates in it, the more he discovers ever new mysteries and subtleties. As a result of this, commentators do present the outcome of their respective deliberations as well. But mysteries and subtleties so described are found acceptable only when they do not go against the five sources mentioned. So should a person, while explaining the Quran, come out with a subtle point or independent judgment which is contrary to the Quran and Sunnah, consensus, language, or the statement of companions and successors, or stands in conflict with another principle of Sharia, then it will have no credence. You may find at some places Israelite reports. So you should know about Israelite reports, that Jadika or Israelites are narratives which have reached us through Jews and Christians. It may be noted that early commentators used to write down all sorts of narration which reached them from unidentified source. Many of these narrations were straight Jadika. Therefore, it is equally necessary to know what they really are. The reality is that some noble companions and their successors first belong to the religion of the people of the book. Later on, when they become Muslims and learn the Quran, they come across several events relating to past communities in the Quran and which they had also read in the books of their previous religion. Therefore, while referring to the events mentioned in the Quran, they would describe other details before Muslim which they had seen in the books of their old religion. These very details have entered into the books of tafsir under the name of Israelite. Hafiz ibn Kasir rahimahullah, who is one of the authentic research scholars, has written that there are three kinds of Israelite. Number one, narrations the truth of which is proved from other evidence of the Quran and Sunnah. For instance, the drowning of Pharaoh and the ascent of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam onto Mount Tur. Number two, narrations the falsity of which is proved from other evidence of the Quran and Sunnah. For instance, it appears in Judaic narrations that Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam had become an apostate in his latter years. Its refutation is proved from the Quran. It is said there, وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانَ, it was not Sulaiman who became an infidel, وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا, but the devils did did become infidels. To cite yet another example, it finds mention in Judaic narrations that Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam committed adultery with the wife of his general Uriah, or having him killed through all sorts of contrivance, ended up marrying his wife. This too is a blatant lie, and taking such narrations to be false is imperative. Number 3, narrations regarding which the Quran, the Sunnah and the Sharia are silent, such as the injunctions of Torah, are subjects about which silence is to be observed, as taught by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Neither confirm nor falsity. There is, however, a difference of opinion among scholars whether or not reporting such narrations is permissible. Hafiz ibn Kasir rahimullah has given the decisive word by saying that reporting these is permissible, all right, but doing so is useless because they cannot be taken as authentic. And now we will talk about a massive misconception about the tafsir of Quran. Hopefully, details mentioned above have made it clear that the tafsir of the Noble Quran is an extremely delicate and difficult undertaking, for which getting to know the Arabic language alone is not enough. In fact, it is necessary to have expertise in all related branches of knowledge. Therefore, scholars say that a mufassir or commentator of the Quran must have vast and deep knowledge of the syntax, etymology, rhetoric and literature of the Arabic language, as well as that prophetic traditions, principles governing jurisprudence and exegesis, doctrinal articles of belief and scholastic. The reason is that one cannot arrive at correct conclusions while explaining the Quran unless there be that adequacy in these fields of knowledge. And it is regrettable that a dangerous epidemic has overtaken Muslims lately, whereby many people have started taking the sole reading ability of Arabic sufficient for the tafsir of the Quran. As a result, anyone who gets to read ordinary Arabic start passing out opinions in the domain of Quranic exegesis. Rather, it has been noticed on occasions that people having just passable familiarity with the Arabic language and who have yet to master their Arabic to perfection take it upon themselves to engage in explaining the Quran following their whims, even going to the limit of finding faults with classical commentators. May it come to worse. Imagine that they have become scholars of the Quran, not even feeling shy of criticizing commentators of great stature. It should be understood very clearly that this is a highly dangerous pattern of behavior, which in matter of religion leads to fatal straying. As regards secular arts and science, everyone can claim to understand that should a person simply learn the English language and go on study books of medical science, he would not be acknowledged as physician by any reasonable person anywhere in the world, and certainly not trustworthy enough to take care of somebody's life unless he has been educated and trained in a medical college. Therefore, having learned English is not all one needs to become a doctor. Similarly, should anyone knowing English hope to become an engineer just by reading through engineering books? It is clear that no sane person in this world would accept him as an engineer. The reason is that this technical expertise cannot be acquired simply by learning the English language. It would rather need a formal training in the discipline under the supervision and guidance of expert teachers. When these stringent requirements are inevitable in order to become a doctor or engineer, how can the learning of Arabic language alone become sufficient in matters relating the Quran and Hadith? In every department of life, everyone knows and acts upon the principles that every art or science has its own particular method of learning and its own peculiar condition. Unless these are fulfilled, the learner's opinion in given arts and science will not be considered trustworthy. If that is so, how can the Quran and the Sunnah become so unclaimed a field of inquiry that there be no need to acquire any art or science in order to explain them, and anyone who so wishes starts passing out opinions in this matter? Allahumma hafazna, and inshallah in our very next lesson we will go in more details. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.